Hello everyone, in this video we will cover the section 16.2. In this section we will see line integrals. Namely, we define an integral that is similar to a single integral, except that instead of integrating over an interval, closed interval from the point A to the point B, we integrate over a curve C. Such integrals are called line integrals, although curve integrals will be better terminology. We will say such an integral as line integrals. They were invented in the early 19th century to solve problems involving fluid flow, forces, electricity and magnetism. Namely, we will define a single integral for functions of two or three variables. Can we define a single integral for functions of two and three variables? We know double integral and triple integral for them, but in here our aim is to define a single integral for functions of two and three variables. So it can be defined over a curve C. We will see the basic definition of this one and a formula. So we start with a plane curve C given by the parametric equations x of t and y of t, or by the vector equation r of t is x of t I plus y of t j, or the normal notation can be written as x of t and y of t for the curve C. If you remember, they are defined by the vector functions denoted by r of t. This is the mathematical expression of the curve. And we assume that bigger C is a smooth curve. That means that we can take the derivative of the vector function with respect to the parameter t, and it is also continuous, and it is not equal to the zero vector for every t. So if we divide the parameter interval, namely the curve is defined from A to B, so we divide this parameter interval into n sub intervals, ti minus 1, ti. You can see in this figure we have the parameter interval from A to B. So we divide this interval into sub intervals. We will use the similar idea to define theoretically the single integral for functions of two and three variables along the curve C. And then each interval has equal width, okay, and we let xi is equal to the image of ti under the first component function, and yi is represented by y of ti. Namely, yi is the image of ti under the second component function of the curve bigger C. Then the corresponding points pi, xi, yi divide the curve into n sub arcs with lengths discriminant s1, discriminant s2, and so on. Okay, after dividing the parameter interval into sub intervals, generally we divide into n sub intervals, so we find the points on the curve which are corresponding to the endpoints of the sub intervals. For example, for this interval whose endpoints are ti minus 1 and ti, so we find the point pi minus 1, which is corresponding to the left endpoint of this interval, and also the right endpoint is corresponding to the point pi on the curve. And then we choose in any arbitrary number in this interval which is corresponding to the point pi star, okay, and the components are xi star and yi star, namely the images of the image of ti star under the component functions of the curve C. So we get a special point for each sub arc, each sub arc on the curve like pi star. Okay, and then the components of these special points will form a special value for the function f, which is written as f of x I star and y I star, and using the components of these special points for every sub arc, so we will get a sum. We will form a sum which is written as here. So f of x I star y I star times, and we use the lengths of the sub arcs discriminant as I. So this is similar to a Riemann sum. Then we take the limit of these sums and make the following definition by analogy with a single integral. When we take the limit of this sum as n goes to infinity, we will get the basic definition of the line integral of the function of two variables. If f is defined on a smooth curve given by equations 1, this one, so then the line integral of f along the curve will be the limit as n goes to infinity of the sum, if this limit exists. Of course, we will not use this theoretical definition to find the line integral of the function f along the curve C. So we will have a formula for this. If f is a continuous function, then the limit here always exists, and the following formula can be used to evaluate the line integral. So f of x I star y I star is corresponding to f of x of t y of t generally from the point A to the P to the point B. Since t is between a and b, and the length of the sub arc is corresponding to the square root of the addition of the squares of the derivatives of the component functions of the curve, if you remember the arc length formula. So we will use this easy formula for finding the line integral of the function f along the curve C. If s of t is the length of C between r of a and r of t, this is the arc length function, if you remember from the chapter 13, then the s over dt will be this one. Okay. Therefore, we can remember the formula 3 by expressing everything in terms of the parameter t. Use the parametric equations to express x and y in terms of t and write ds as this one. So this integral becomes from a to b f of x of t y of t ds. Okay, instead of the square root, we write just ds. So just as for an ordinary single integral, we can interpret the line integral of a positive function as an area. In fact, if function is a non-negative function, so the line integral of this function represents, along the curve, represents the area of one side of the fence or curtain in figure 2, whose base is the curve C and whose height above the point xy is f of xy. Namely, we can find the half of the surface area of this shape in three-dimensional coordinate system if we know the base curve C, and we can find the height of this area by finding the value of the function at the point on the curve. We will apply this procedure for every point on the curve, and then we can easily find the area of the surface area of this shape. Okay, this is the geometric interpretation of the line integral, which is similar to the geometric interpretation of the single integral, because The single integral of a function of one variable gives the area under the curve which is defined as the equation of the function, namely y is equal to f of x. Okay, for example, let's evaluate the line integral of the function 2 plus x squared times y, where a bigger C is the upper half of the unit circle, x squared plus y squared is equal to 1. Namely, the curve is given implicitly. So in order to use formula, we should find the parametric equations of the curve. So recall that the unit circle can be parameterized by means of the equations x is equal to cosine t and y is equal to sine t, because when write them into the equation written here, we get 1. Therefore, the unit circle can be represented by the vector function r of t such that its components are cosine t and sine t, if you remember. And t is between 0 and pi because we have the upper half of the unit circle in the example. So t will be from 0 to pi. Okay, from 0 to pi. You can see the graph of the unit circle, upper half of the unit circle, which means y is positive, namely non-negative. Therefore, the formula gives the line integral of the function is equal to the integral from 0 to pi, single integral. Instead of x and y, we write the parametric components of the curve of component functions, cosine t and sine t. Therefore, we get cosine square t plus sine t times the arc length formula, square root of the derivative of cosine t, which is minus sine t. Therefore, we get sine square t for the first term, and the derivative of sine is cosine. Therefore, we get cosine square t for the second one. And from here, sine square t plus cosine square t is equal to 1. Just we have the first term in the multiplication, and then the integral of the number 2 is 2 times t. For the second one, you can use the substitution rule, namely if red u is equal to cosine t, so we will obtain du is equal to minus sine t dt. And writing them here, we get the integral which is cosine to the power 3 over 3 from 0 to pi. Therefore, we get 2 pi plus 2 over 3. That's it. Just we use the formula for finding the line integral of the function written here. So suppose now that bigger C is a piecewise smooth curve, that is, namely, C is a union of a finite number of smooth curves, C1, C2, blah, blah, Cn. Namely, we have different curves, but the initial point of the next curve is the terminal point of the previous one, like C1, C2. The terminal point of C1 is the initial point of C2. So we get a curve, actually. This total curve is the union of the subcurves, actually. Then we define the integral of f along the curve C as the sum of the integrals of f along each of the smooth pieces of C. Okay? Like this one. Okay? For example, evaluate the line integral of the function 2 times x, where c consists of the arc c1 of the parabola y is equal to x square, and from 0, 0 to 1 to 1, followed by the vertical line segment c2 from 1 to 1 to 1 to 2. So let's sketch this curve, which is the union of two subcurves. Actually, this is the parabola until 1 to 1, okay, 1 to 1, and from 1 to 1 to 1 to namely the vertical line. Okay, the vertical line, namely this one. This is the part of the parabola y is equal to x squared until the number, the point 1 to 1, and then it is followed by the vertical line segment from this point to the point 1 to 2. So what is the line integral of the given function along this curve? This is the union of two subcurves. So the curve C is shown in this figure. So C1 is the graph of a function of x, y is equal to x squared. So we can choose x as the parameter, and then equations for C1 become, namely we try to find the vector function for the parabola, y is equal to x squared. If we choose the parameter t as the first component, so its vector function r of t, the vector function of the parabola will be t squared, because the second component is x squared. So we write t squared, okay, t squared. And t is between 0 and 1 for C1, because the starting point is the origin, the terminal point is 1 to 1, which means the first component is between 0 and 1, therefore t is between 0 and 1, 0 and 1. So the integral of the function along C1 is equal to, actually we write t for x to t, so it is equal to, in this parameterization, so we write from 0 to 1, we write 2 times t square root of the derivative of the first component, which is equal to 1, therefore we have 1 square, which is equal to 1, plus the integral of the second component is 2t, therefore we write for t squared dt. From here, again applying the substitution rule, namely you will write u is equal to 1 plus 4 times t squared, and you will change the limit points according to the new variable of the integration, and you will obtain these results. Okay, you can easily compute this integral and you will obtain this number. And similarly, for the second subcurve, we choose y as the parameter. So the equations, because we have the vertical line, which means x is always 1 for the second curve. Therefore, its vector function will be, the first component is 1, which is a constant. The second component is t, because just the second component is change. Therefore, for C2, the vector function is 1 and t. So the integral becomes, the line integral becomes, let's write here, from 0, so it is the second component is between 1 and 2, therefore the limit points of the single integral will be 1 and 2, and the function is 2x, and the first component is 1, therefore we write 1 for x, therefore we get 2 times the square root of dx over dt, dx over dt. Dx over dt is 0, from the formula dx over dt is 0, squared is equal to 0, plus dy over dt, namely the derivative of the second component, which is equal to 1, 1 squared is equal to 1 dt. Okay, just we have the number 2 here, its derivative is 2 times t, from 0 to 1. So we get 2 for the second one. Adding the results, we get the line integral of the function According to the formula written here, along the curve C, we consist of the subcurves C1 and C2. Okay. So two other line integrals are obtained by replacing the length of the sub arc by either the change in the variable x or the change in the variable y. In the definition too, they are called the line integrals of the function f along the curve with respect to x and y, and it is written in this form. They are written in this form: f of x by dx along the curve C is equal to this one. They are the theoretical definitions. So when we want to distinguish the original line integral from those in equations 5 and 6, we call it the line integral with respect to arc length. Okay. Namely, the line integral is said to be the line integral with respect to arc length, and they are called line integrals of the function of f, the function f along the curve with respect to the variables x and y respectively. The following formulas say that the line integrals with respect to x and y can also be evaluated by expressing everything in terms of t, namely we will write the component functions of the curve in the definition of the function. So it becomes f of x of t y of t times, instead of the arc length, we use the derivative of the first component function, which is written as x prime of t dt. And the second is similarly can be, the second is similarly written as the single integral from a to b f of x of t y prime of t dt. The general case, if we don't consider the independent variables f of x y ds is equal to f of x of t y of t ds, where ds, you know, is equal to the first derivative of the first component function to the power 2 plus dy over dt to the power 2 dt. Okay, they are the line integrals of the function of two variables with respect to arc length, which is the first one, with respect to x, which is the second one, and with respect to y. So it frequently happens that line integrals with respect to x and y occur together. When this happens, it is customary to abbreviate by writing in this form. Okay. Vector representation of the line segment that starts at R0 and ends at R1 is given by the equation 8, you see. We know actually from the section 12.5 from the chapter 12, if you remember. This is the equation 12.5.4. This is the vector representation of the line segment from the point which is corresponding to the R0. This is the position vector of the starting point, and R1 is the position of the position vector of the terminal point. So evaluate the line integral of y square and x with respect to x and with respect to y respectively along the curve C, where C is C1 for the first question, is the line segment from the point minus 5, minus 3, minus 3 to 0 to 2, and B, the second question, C2, the curve C2 is the arc of the parabola x is equal to 4 minus y square from the point minus 5, minus 3 to the point 0 to 2. Okay. First, we will find the line integral with respect to x and y along the curve C1, and then we take the integral, line integral, along the curve C2. So a parametric representation for the line segments easily found by using the formula. Instead of R0, we write its position, R0, we write the position vector of the starting point, which has the components minus 5 and minus 3. Therefore, from here, R of t for the curve C1, R of t is equal to 1 minus t times minus 5. Minus 3 plus t times this position vector of the terminal point has the components 0 and 2. So from here we obtain the first component is 5t minus 5, and the second component is 5t minus 3, and t is between 0 and 1 according to the formula written here. This is the vector function of the line segment from the point has the components minus 5 minus 3 and the terminal to the point is 0 to 2. Therefore, the line integral of this one is equal to, along the curve C1, from 0 to 1, y is equal to 5t minus 3. Therefore, we have 5t minus 3 to the power 2 times dx, which means the derivative of the first component, which is equal to 5 dt, plus x is equal to 5t minus 5 times dy, which is the derivative of the second component dt, again 5 times dt, and from here we obtain this term, and integrating this one we get minus 5 over 6. Since the for the second curve C2, since the parabola is given as a function of y, x is equal to 4 minus y square in the example, so we will find actually its vector function by considering the parameter t as the variable y, since the parabola is given in terms of y, namely the first component will be 4 minus t squared, 4 minus t squared, and the second component is the variable y. Okay. Therefore, the integral along the parabola of the function written here will be equal to y squared, namely t squared, times dx, which is equal to minus 2 times d dt plus t is between minus 3 and 2 according to the initial and terminal points. Therefore we write from minus 3 to 2 by looking at the second components, plus x is equal to 4 minus t squared, 4 minus t squared, times dy, namely the derivative of t, which is equal to 1 times dt is equal to dt. And after computing this integral, this is very easy, you will obtain this result. Okay. So in general, a given parametrization x of t, namely if you know the component functions of the curve, So it determines an orientation of a curve C with the positive direction corresponding to increasing values of the parameter t. If you consider this figure, so if we consider the initial point A and the terminal point B, so C is in the direction from the point A to the point B. You can see the direction of the arrow. So if minus C denotes the curve consisting of the same points as C, we have the same curve, but now the initial point is B and the terminal point is the point A. So we say it is in the opposite direction. It is in the opposite direction. So how can we find the line integral in the opposite direction of any function? So it is equal to, if we want to take the line integral of the function f with respect to x, so it will be equal to minus the line integral over the along the curve c of the function f dx, and similarly with respect to y, it is equal to minus the normal line integral. But if we integrate with respect to arc length, if we use the general, the first definition, the value of the line integral does not change when we reverse the orientation of the curve. Okay, with respect to arc length, the line integral of the function f will be the same, because you know it represents the area such that the base curve is the curve C. Therefore, the result will not change. So line integrals in space, we know, suppose that bigger C is a smooth space curve given by the parametric equations. Similarly, we will generalize the definition of line integral to three-dimensional case. So the vector function has three components, x, y, and z of t. If f is a function of three variables that is continuous on some region containing the curve, then we define the line integral of f along c in a manner similar to that for plane curves. Similarly, just we add the third component and we use the same formula, f of x of t, y of t, and we add the third component, and similarly we add the third term written here. We have the same formula for functions of three variables. So observe that the integrals in both formulas 3 and 9, the first one is valid for functions of two variables, the second, this one, is valid for functions of three variables, can be written in the more compact vector notation by just directly using the vector function r of t instead of x of t, y of t, z of t, because we know rt has the representation written in this form, x of t, y of t, and z of t. This is actually the position vector of the point x of t, y of t, and z of t. Therefore, instead of this rotation, just we can write r of t written here, f of r of t, and this one is actually the length of the curve. The arc length function, the derivative of the arc length function. Therefore, we can write this one as, this is actually the length of the tangent vector to the curve. Therefore, we can write the norm of the derivative of the vector function dt. Okay. This is actually the derivative of the length of the curve. For the special case, if f is a constant which is equal to 1, so just we have the length, the norm of the tangent vector to the curve from the point A to B. So this is equal to the length of the curve. Okay, this is the special case of the line integral with respect to arc length. Line integrals along the curve C with respect to x, y and z can also be defined. For example, with respect to z, it is equal to f of x of t, y of t, z of t times z prime of t dt, like the previous formulas. Therefore, as with the line integrals in the plane, we evaluate integrals of the form by expressing everything x, y, z, dx, dy, dz in terms of the parameter t, like this one, okay? P dx, q dy, r dz can be computed along the curve C using the parametric form of the curve. For example, evaluate the integral of y times sine z along the curve C. C is the circular helix given by the equations x is equal to cosine t, y is equal to sine t, z is equal to t if t is between 0 and 2 pi. Instead of y directly, we write sine t. We use the parametric equations of the curve. Z is equal to t, therefore we write sine t. And then we take the derivatives of the component functions with respect to t of the curve. And then we get sine square t, cosine square t, and the derivative of z is equal to 1. Therefore, we get 1 squared is equal to 1 from 0 to 2 pi. And here we have square root of 2 and sine square t, which is equal to 1 over 2 times 1 minus cosine 2 by using the half angle formula, which is a trigonometric identity, if you remember. And then computing this integral, we obtain square root of 2 times pi. Okay. Another example, evaluate the line integral of the function y times dx plus z times dy plus x times dz, where c consists of the line segment c1 from the point 200 to the point 345, followed by the vertical line segment c2 from the point 345 to the point 340. Okay. The first one is the line segment from the point 200 to the point 345. 200 is on the x-axis, 345 is located here. And from here to here, we have the line segment C1 and the vertical line segment C2 from the point 345 to the point 340 will be in this form. Okay, the orientations are very important. You see the directions. To determine the parametric equations of these curves, similarly, we will use the formula written here, if you remember, from the section 12.5, 1 minus tr0, which is the initial which is the position vector of the initial point, and r1 is the position vector of the terminal point. So we write 1 minus t, the position vector of the initial point has the components 1 200, plus t times 345 becomes this one, and in parametric form we know the components. So along c1 we can find the line integral y is equal to 40. And dx, namely the derivative of the first component, is 1 with respect to t. Therefore, we write 1 times dt, which is equal to dt. Z is equal to 5t. And the derivative of the second component is 4 times dt. And similarly, you can find the third one. X, 2 plus t. Dz is the derivative of third component, 5 dt. Easily we can find 24.5. Likewise, C2 can be written in the form using the same idea and using the similar computation, you can find easily the line integral along C2, which is equal to minus 15, adding the values of these integrals, we obtain the result. We obtain the line integral of the function written here. Okay, the work W done by the force field F is the line integral with respect to arc length. Here we have an application of line integral in physics. So the work bigger W done by the force field bigger F, this is a vector field function, is the line integral with respect to arc length of the tangential component of the force, written in this form. The work can be found by evaluating the line integral along C of the dot product of the force field and tangential component of the force T, F dot product T ds. If the curve C is given by the vector function R of T written here, you know, so the tangent vector to this curve will be unit tangent vector will be r prime of t over its length, you know, from the chapter 13. So we can rewrite this formula as instead of t we write r prime of t over its length. We use r of t for stating the point x, y, z. And ds is equal to, you know, the length of the tangent vector to the curve dt. And from here, by removing the the length of the r prime of t, we just have r f of r of t dot product, the derivative of the vector function, which represents the curve C from the point A to the point B. So let bigger bold F be a continuous vector field defined on a smooth curve bigger C given by a vector function R of T from the point A to the point B. Then the line integral of this vector field along the vector along the curve C is equal to it is denoted by the integral along the curve C f dot product dr, or this term, this representation, or the previous representation. Okay, we use one of them to state the line integral of the vector field along the curve C. For example, find the work done by the force field given here in moving a particle along the quarter circle r of t cosine t I plus sine t j, t is between 0 and pi over 2, quarter circle. We have a quarter circle. You know already the component functions of the curve cosine t and sine t. Therefore, f of r of t will be cosine square t I minus cosine t sine t j, and the derivative of the curve will be minus sine t I cosine t j. Therefore, the work done is equal to, from the formula here, f of rt is cosine square t minus this one and r prime of t this one, finding the dot product of them, namely cosine square t times minus sine t, and we have the same term for the multiplication of the second components. Therefore we have minus 2 times cosine square t sine t, and using the substitution rule here, namely you will say cosine t is equal to u. Therefore, easily you can find the integral of this function with respect to t, which is equal to minus 2 over t. And similarly, evaluate the line integral of the vector field f, which is defined here, and c is the cubic curve whose parametric equations are given here, where t is between 0 and 1. So we know r of t, the parametric equation of this curve, so we can find easily its derivative by considering the components separately, and we can easily find the value of the vector field at the vector function r of t. Just we write t and t square and t to the power 3 for x, y and z here, and just we find the dot product of them here, and then integrating this one we can easily find the work done by the force field F. Okay, finally we know the connection between line integrals of vector fields and line integrals of scalar fields. Suppose the vector field F on three-dimensional space is given in component form by the equation P, Q and R. We have the scalar functions of three variables. So we use the definition 13, this one, definition 13, to compute its line integral along C here. Instead of the parametric function, we use the scalar functions of the vector field. Instead of this one, we write pi plus qj plus rk times x prime, y prime, z prime, which are the components of the derivative of the vector function of the curve. Then finding the dot product of them, we get this term, which is the explicit expression in terms of the scalar functions P, Q and R. Okay, instead of using the vector notation, we use the scalar component of the vector field. But this last integral is precisely the line integral in 10. Therefore, we have the line integral of the vector field is actually equal to p dx, q dy, r dz, where f pi plus qj plus rk. For example, the line integral in example 6 could be expressed as f times dot product dr, where f has the components y, z and x. Namely, the line integral of the vector field f is just the line integral of the scalar functions P, Q and R if you know the parametric equation of the curve C. Thank you very much.